Yeah, so this is a common phrase, seeing is believing. But actually, what I plan to do is kind of invert this a little bit and talk. Oh, where's my? There it is. And talk about instead about how beliefs get in the way. And I'm going to be focused on in the next 18 minutes about how our beliefs impact what we think we see, and the almost infinite capability of really smart people to fool themselves. Now, before I went in doing what I'm doing now, and before I went into science, I actually went to fine arts college. And one of the first things we learned in drawing class was drawing what you see, not what you think you see. This is maybe not one of my best works, but it kind of shows where we start from as kids, drawing what we think the world should look like. This is, of course, by Da Vinci, who saw the world very clearly around him, perhaps better than anybody before or since. We often talk about the similarity between art and science, and I think one of the key areas where they're similar is this conscious effort we need to make to get past, to break through our preconceptions and really, really see. Now, in cosmology and astrophysics and planetary sciences, we have a list of beliefs that have evolved and entrenched as dogma that have shaped and driven our collective abstracted view of what the universe looks around us. And while these beliefs and dogma persist, they impose an intervening filter on what we think we see. It's a bit like a viewmaster of belief. It sort of gets in the way. And one of the beliefs I'm going to focus on here in my examples is this belief, this dogmatic view that the dynamics of stellar bodies is completely dominated by gravitational and mechanical forces, that planets and moons and asteroids move through a vacuum, isolated and electrically disconnected from each other. This dogma really keeps us from the possibility that planetary bodies are charged relative to their surrounding space, and that we should expect to see electric currents flowing between space and the planetary surfaces. So the examples I'm going to give are examples of energetic surface events on planets and moons that in each case are clearly in an accepted way associated with electrical events and attributes. But in each case, the predominant model continues to be a gravitational mechanical view. So let's begin. Let's look at Mars. Mars has a continuing fascination, and probably no point in history have we had more new data about what's happening on the surface of Mars. Well, what are we seeing? It was a big surprise when we got there, we saw dust devils. I mean, how is it in an atmosphere that's 1% as dense of that as Earth that this rarefied atmosphere can form and maintain these coherent columns of dust? How is that possible? Well, actually, a clue about dust devils on Mars came when NASA and university researchers working in the Arizona desert discovered unexpectedly high electric fields around these dust devils. In one example that I read about in their paper, the electric field around a 7-meter wide dust devil actually exceeded the measuring capability of their sensor, which is 10,000 volts per meter. Now, in the talk we saw this morning from Michael, the fair weather electric field is somewhere around 100 volts per meter. If it gets up to 2,000 volts per meter, you're in serious danger of getting hit by lightning. So the researchers concluded that a 10-meter-ish dust devil would produce an electric field in the range of 10,000 volts per meter. Now, that actually exceeds the breakdown potential of the Martian atmosphere, so that electric field on Mars would be expected to be associated with various kinds of electric discharge, like arcing between the dust in your spacesuit and your vehicle. Now, keep in mind that the dominant model here is that the electric fields, these unexpectedly large electric fields, are a byproduct of the dust devil, that it's the saltation, it's the agitation of the dust and the dust grains banging together, it's a mechanical thing, produce this charge separation that creates this massive electric field. This is an example of a Martian dust devil looking down on it. It's 70 meters across, it's 20 kilometers high. You see that the vortex is very well organized along its entire length. Interesting to know what the electric field is associated with this thing. This is a video that I found of a Martian dust devil. What I was impressed by when I reviewed the various videos of Martian dust devil, how bright the dust devil is at the base. And it makes me think of what Wall showed this morning about these electrical volcanoes, about how they get discharges towards the base and the bright along the sides and sort of dark in the middle. This picture is part of a larger image from the thermal emission imaging system from the Mars Odyssey mission. And this shows energetic vortexes propelling dust into the Martian atmosphere. This is along the south polar cap of Mars. Wall Thornhill, for some time, has predicted that electric currents flowing between space and the surface of Mars will drive these electric vortexes, power the dust devils, and power these kinds of global widespread storms. What we're talking about here is the electrical modification of the Martian surface through individual dust devils moving, making dark trails across the Martian landscape, which is something we see, to these kinds of widespread storms. But where does the energy come from? How does it happen? Well, electric theory would predict that electric charge is accumulated and stored in a planetary capacitor, which is the ionosphere. This has the potential for planet-altering events when the atmosphere finally breaks down and massive discharge events occur. So what we're talking about is electrical energy storage in this atmospheric capacitor that directly communicates to the surface of Mars through electrical vortexes. It's the electric field that drives the vortexes and results in these planet-wide dust storms. So we would expect to see massive aggregations of energetic vortexes driving dust storms. We would expect to see high altitude, high velocity winds. But this is what we believe. So you go onto the NASA website, you do a search on Mars dust devils, and this is the kind of picture that you see. So we're talking about a gravitational mechanical model. Solar heating of the surface causes hot air to rise, gravitation puts in place convection currents, horizontal wind comes in, dips the thing up on its end, and the whirling air pulls the dust and dust grains up, and their saltation and agitation creates the charge separation resulting in these massive electric fields. Oh, a few problems with this model. First of all, it's hard to imagine how solar radiation on the Martian surface would produce the kind of energy required to drive those electric fields. It's hard to imagine how the rarefied atmosphere could actually lift the dust grains up in this whirling wind to actually do the agitation, the mechanical work to create these electric fields. And how do you get this model to work for these huge aggregation for vortexes that drive dust so high up into the atmosphere, especially when once the dust storm starts, it's kind of self-limiting because the solar radiation can't get to the surface to keep it driving. So I would propose here we've got sort of a Viewmaster effect at work. But fair enough, let's go look at even more energetic events on a fairly well-documented moon of Jupiter, Io. So it's a beautiful picture. Io orbits close into Jupiter, inducing something of like about 400,000 volts across the planetary diameter, something like a million ampere current flowing through Io. This tremendous current flows across the magnetic field into the electrical environment of Jupiter. It's been accepted for some time that Io is in an electric circuit with Jupiter. It's well known, it's well accepted. Well, what do we see? Well, this is a fairly famous five-frame sequence of a 330-kilometer high plume above the Tvashtar Patera. What you see is a fairly regular symmetrical umbrella shape. If you look more closely, you see braids and filaments and knots making up this umbrella-shaped plume. Now, when these things were first observed, the model that was proposed was a gravitational sort of mechanical model that is volcanic. But actually, very early on, about 1979, the astrophysicist Tommy Gold proposed an electrical approach. He said these energetic phenomena that we're observing maybe aren't volcanic, but instead it's this million ampere current creating electric arc discharge where the current concentrates at certain points in the Io crust. This idea was advanced by Dessler and Parrott in 88 when they likened the plumes to what you observe with this kind of plasma focus device. And you get the same sort of shape as you would see in those plumes of Io. Now, there are certain kinds of predictions that fall out of an electrical model. First of all, the hot spots associated with these plumes should be too hot to be lava. Second of all, you should see these hot spots concentrated along crater walls. Wall has predicted that because cathode jets, which is what we're looking at, would favor those sharp crater walls. You would expect to see UV emission, which is something that you would get with arc discharge, but not with lava. And these cathode jets would move. They would migrate across the surface because they're not associated with a physical volcanic vent. Well, this is the first regional scale thermal image of NIMS device looking at Io. The upper left-hand arrow is Thor, which is the biggest plume observed up to that point. You can see the black pixels in the center of Thor, where the pixels have been saturated because it's too hot. And indeed, it was found that some of these hot spots around the caldera exceeded 2,000 degrees Celsius, in excess of what we'd expect with lava, and were actually probably hotter, but we couldn't tell because we couldn't measure it. This is another thermal image showing these hot spots organized along a pateral wall. Note how evenly spaced they are, which is something you would actually expect to see with cathode jets who tend to evenly space themselves. UV image, upper right-hand corner, you see Pele in UV while it's emitting a plume, and it's a UV hotspot. And the Kafka, of course, is the fact that, well, the plume at Prometheus has been observed to actually move around, and it's moved about 80 kilometers since the late 70s. So here we have, okay, ions known to be associated in an electric circuit with Jupiter. There was an actual electrical explanation put forward right at the beginning in the late 70s that this was an electrical event through electric arc discharge. We have a whole series of observations that are contrary to the volcanic model, but certainly fit with an electrical view of things. And what do we believe? Well, once again, you do a search on the NASA website for the explanatory model for this thing, and it's volcanic. It's completely gravitational and mechanical. You've got a silicate lava interior. It erupts through cracks in this silicate crust. A convection current gets set up in the sulfur ocean that's seeped up over billions of years. The convection current rips a hole in the sulfur crust. You get hot flows coming out, evaporates the sulfur snow, and you get a plume. What's interesting is they've drawn the plume, the shape that they observe, but this model in no way predicts the plume should have that shape. So we definitely have the viewmaster going here and in imposing what they observe on something that doesn't really explain what they observe. Okay, well, let's look at one more moon. And this is actually small frozen moon around Saturn, Enceladus. Small, it's about 500 kilometers across, it's frozen. And for such a tiny, small, frozen moon, you wouldn't expect much going on, but actually it's been full of surprises. First of all, it's a lot hotter in the South Pole than it really should have been, about 10 times more thermal output, about 15.8 gigawatt, so 10x more than we expected. So what's happening there? We also see that that thermal energy is concentrated along these fissures called tiger stripes along the South Pole. And when you look at those tiger stripes more closely, you see these jets being emitted from those fissures. Look a lot like cathode jets, but more than that, they're really energetic. I mean, these things are jetting this water particles, water vapor, thousands of kilometers into space. They look a bit like cathode arcs, and you start getting used to seeing what they look like. They're evenly spaced, as you might expect as well. Now, where's the electrical current? Well, in 2008, Cassini detected unexpectedly high proton densities around the moon, and also measured a field line electron beam. It was thought that this should create an auroral footprint on Saturn, and a few weeks later, Cassini actually imaged an auroral footprint of Enceladus on the northern Saturn hemisphere. In 2009, a group of Cassini scientists detected signals that were consistent with a magnetic filament going from Enceladus to the upper Saturn atmosphere. So clearly there is an electric circuit here. So there's an electric circuit, there's things that look like cathode jets. And what do we believe? Well, you go onto the NASA website and you've got the same sort of story. It's a mechanical model, it's geysers. This is actually on the astronomy picture of the day. Well, it's not an astronomy picture, it's an artist's conception of a scientific misconception that this is geysers. And it's the same sort of model. You have internal heating. There's no explanation why it's 10 times what it should be through tidal and radioactive heating. You've got some subcrust ocean, convection currents, ripping a vent in the ice crust. And those vents happen to be shaped like perfect kinds of cylinders so that you can jet a coherent and collimated jet of water, ice particles, and so on. So yeah, we're back in ViewMaster territory again. So I haven't added any new information about these energetic events on Mars and these moons. My fascination is more about this dogmatic adherence to a gravitational and mechanically dominated universe. And what I'm fascinated by is the infinite capability of really smart people to fool themselves. I mean, these are literally rocket scientists. I mean, this is NASA, right? So what I'm learning from this, and what I've learned from the work I do, is that It's the really intelligent, the really smart ones come up with the best viewmasters. They're the most sophisticated, complicated, and they present the most beautiful images. What we have to do is keep batting away the viewmaster and get people to really see. That's all. Thank you.